Good afternoon, everyone. I'm going to call to order this meeting of the Health, Environment, and Community Engagement Committee. Welcome. We have a full committee here. I'm Cam Gordon. I'm chair of the committee, and I'm joined by council members Fry, Bender, Andrew Johnson, Glidden, and Cano. And we have 8 items are on our agenda today. The first item is a public hearing about the energy utility franchise ordinances. But prior to that, I'm going to go through the consent agenda so that some people who may be here for one of those items don't have to wait through what I think will, however, be a very interesting public hearing you might want to stay for anyway. But let me move forward with the consent items, and if any committee member wants to pull any of these off for discussion, we can do that. The first one is confirming the mayoral appointment of Jesus Perez to the Minneapolis Food Council. The second one is approving a resolution recognizing Friday, October 24th as Food Day in the city of Minneapolis. The next item is approving use of $13,000 of Hennepin County's special 7.5% NRP funds to address homelessness in downtown Minneapolis. The fifth item on our agenda is approval of an amended NRP policy plan action to reduce the university neighborhood NRP allocation of $75,000 and amend the Sumner Glenwood NRP allocation by increasing it by $75,000. The sixth and seventh item on the agenda are both to set public hearings. The sixth is to set the public hearing for October 20th. On our ordinance amendments to our short-term food permits. And the seventh item is to set the public hearing on our Clean Indoor Air Act, indoor smoking, also known as electronic cigarettes and electronic delivery devices, ordinance amendment. The agenda said we would set that for November 3rd. I had a request from a council member to move that to November 17th because November 3rd is right before the election. They raised an interesting point that some people might have a harder time coming on the Monday before Election Day. So I would like to move that to November 17th. Anyone want to discuss any of those items? Then all those in favor of those as stated, please say aye.
Aye.
Any opposed, say no. Those motions carry. And now we're ready to move on to our first item on the agenda, the Energy Utilities Franchise Ordinances. And before we go to our public hearing, I would like to ask Mr. Strobel to come forward and or any other staff that he sees fit to give us a little presentation and answer any questions that the committee members may have. Welcome.
Thank you. Thank you, Chair Gordon, members of the committee. My name is Jay Strobel, and I'm the Deputy City Coordinator here in the City of Minneapolis. I'm going to be providing for you all a bit of a background on what brought us here today. Spend a little bit of time on providing an overview of the Clean Energy Partnership Agreement, as well as the franchise agreement, and then follow that with a few slides on next steps. In terms of background, what brought us here today, the last time the city updated their utility franchise agreements was 20 years ago with Xcel Energy and CenterPoint Energy. Those agreements largely dealt with right-of-way issues. Since then, the city has focused much more of its time and attention on issues dealing with energy and climate issues. Back in 2013, just last year, the city adopted the Climate Action Plan. This plan laid out an approach and a strategies for adopting 15% and 30% greenhouse gas emissions reduction goals with a specific focus on strategies around how to do that relative to our buildings, transportation, waste, and energy systems. Earlier this year, the city produced Energy Pathways Report, which explored multiple options for achieving the energy vision within the context of the utility negotiations. Keeping on our current path, the report identified would not allow us to meet our energy goals. From that, ultimately, the strategy that we ended up pursuing was to negotiate both sort of a two-pronged strategy of working on a franchise agreement and also clean energy agreements simultaneously, both focusing on a shorter-term franchise agreement tied to the formation and outcomes of a clean energy partnership agreement with Xcel Energy and CenterPoint Energy. So that's what brought us here today. I'm gonna spend the next few slides walking through some of the specifics of the clean energy partnership first, and then move on to the franchise agreement. Just very pleased today to share with you the framework for establishing the first in the nation city utility clean energy partnership. We really consider this a transformative agreement, combining the collective resources of the Xcel Energy, CenterPoint Energy, the City of Minneapolis, including the utility's expertise and the city's regulatory and relationship assets towards the achievement of the city's climate action plan goals and the energy vision. In terms of the structure of the clean energy partnership board, which is sort of the key component of the energy partnership, this board would consist of 8 members, 4 from the city, 4 from the utilities. We expect that this board would be supported by both a staff team of city and utility staff, as well as Energy Vision Advisory Committee. This Energy Vision Advisory Committee will be established by the partnership board, and we expect broad representation from the community, including representatives from the business community, neighborhoods, environmental justice, and other technical experts. The first advisory committee meeting we would expect to happen in early 2015. In terms of the charge of the advisory committee, the advisory committee would not be a decision-making body per se, but its work would primarily be around supporting the work of the partnership board to review and make recommendations on a 2-year work plan, annual performance reports, researching and providing feedback on special initiatives as requested by the board, and then also outreach and promotion of the board's initiatives through member networks. Well, I'd refer people to Exhibit A for a more complete list. A few of the examples of the types of priorities we could expect the partnership board to address would address issues such as establishing a multifamily energy efficiency program, successfully implementing a community solar garden program, exploring new renewable energy options for city facilities, studying underground and alternative transmission line designs, LED streetlights, further exploring green zone concepts. Again, these are just a few examples. These would not only work to move us forward on achieving the city's clean energy goals, but also to move us forward in areas such as environmental and racial justice as well. The proposal would be that the partnership board and that the advisory committee would meet on a sort of a quarterly basis, although that can be determined down the road by the board itself. But then also that the staff teams, both from the utility and the city, would meet on a more frequent basis, again, in support of the board and the advisory committee. In terms of accountability and reporting, we expect that the board will present at least annually to the city council and to utilities leadership on the progress made on the development and implementation of a 2-year work plan and the overall goals, and that they may identify some specific measures to track progress towards our reduction in climate energy goals. Turning our focus now to the franchise agreements, both utilities and the city have agreed to a shorter-term franchise agreement. The base agreement would be for a 10-year agreement as a maximum and a 5-year minimum agreement. If after 4 years of the partnership that there is not a good faith effort to honor the commitment of the clean energy partnership, the city could give notice of termination, which would require 9 votes of the council. If things are going well after year 10 and after year 15 of the agreement, there could be 2 5-year extensions based on agreement by the utilities and the city. So again, the base agreement is for 10 years, but allowing up to potentially 20. Other elements of the agreement I'd like to highlight is that the city does maintain and control the use of its right-of-way. In terms of the fee structures, that the fee structure would be similar, exactly the same as it exists today, promoting revenue stability and for the city and minimizing impact on its customers. A small change was also put in place in terms of the franchise agreements to encourage minimizing impact on lane usage when project work is underway. And then finally, the agreement also calls for Xcel Energy and the Park Board to work cooperatively to address issues such as tree trimming and tree removal that we know are important. While the city and utilities meet on a regular basis today, the franchise agreement does more formalize an annual meeting between the utilities and the city to allow for an opportunity for a greater discussion on any right-of-way issues that might be of conflict between the city and the utilities. Both utilities have agreed to provide information regarding reliability, infrastructure investments, and capital improvements. In addition, whether it's through the action of the Minnesota Public Utilities Commission or through the Clean Energy Partnership, we look forward to working with utilities on getting greater information on customer usage and program participation data. So in summary, to a great extent, the city has achieved the core recommendations of the Energy Pathways study in terms of a shorter franchise term, contingent on progress on the establishment and the results of the Clean Energy Partnership. In terms of next steps, to formalize the new franchise ordinances and the Clean Energy Partnership Agreement, following my presentation, there's going to be a public hearing at this committee today, and then it'll ultimately end up in a full City Council vote on October 17th. Assuming all that proceeds as planned, the utilities will initiate a process to bring the ordinances to the Minnesota Public Utilities Commission towards the end of the month, put everything in place to have these agreements go live at the beginning of 2015. Additionally, city and utility staff will begin work on developing ideas for a potential two-year work plan for the Clean Energy Partnership. In addition, the work plan and the advisory committee membership would be approved by the Clean Energy Partnership Board in early 2015. I'd also like to note that the city will continue to work with and advance our energy and climate goals through active work with the Minnesota Public Utilities Commission and through our legislative agenda. Finally, a lot of work has gone into getting us here today, so I'd like to just do a few thank yous. First, to Mayor Hodges, Council President Johnson, Council Vice President Glidden, Council Member Gordon, the leaders from Xcel Energy, the leaders from CenterPoint Energy, for their ongoing leadership and support over this many months process. Also like to specifically call out the negotiation teams for CenterPoint Energy, Brenda Bjorklund, Jeff Doherty, Nick Mark, Doug Peterson, Al Swintek, Joe Vorlums. From Xcel Energy, Laura McCartan, Pat Klein, Jennifer Thielen-Smith, Bridget McLaughlin. And then from the city, in addition to myself, Peter Ginder, Stephanie Zawasowski, Kevin Carpenter, and then there was additional support from the city, from Gale Press, Brendan Slaughterbach, Brett Jelly from Public Works, Robin Garwood, and then finally from the Center for Energy and Environment, Mike Bull and Sheldon Strom were invaluable advisors to us in the process. And I'd especially like to highlight the work of Peter Ginder, Jennifer Thielen-Smith, and Brenda Bjorklund. They're the attorneys that represented the three parties, and a lot of countless hours went in for these three folks to get us to where we are today. So with that, I'm happy to take any questions.
Well, thank you very much. Appreciate the summary and also all the hard work that you put into this coordinating. And I notice your name didn't appear there on the thanks to the negotiating team, but it certainly should have. I do see a question. Councilmember Fry.
Thank you, Mr. Chair, and seriously amazing job. I know the negotiation was long and arduous, but I think we're at a decent place right now. Couple questions. The first, in order to terminate the contract, which will take 1 year following the 5-year minimum, I think you said it would take 9 council votes. And this may be a question for the clerk's office or you. Is that a normal procedure, 9 votes to eliminate a city contract?
Chair Gordon, Councilmember Frye, just a quick clarification on your statement. It's after year 4 that the city would have to give 12 years notice.
12 months.
I'm sorry, 12 months notice. I need to clarify my own remarks, I guess. 12 months notice, so it's after year 4. So the expectation is that after 4 years that the city, the utilities would be in a good position to sort of evaluate progress of the Clean Energy Partnership, and that at year 4 that a decision could be made, or at any point thereafter, year 4. In terms of the 9 votes, in rare instances or in instances where there is a higher threshold of decision making, the council does have their certain actions that does require a supermajority or 9 votes to make those types of decisions. And as part of the negotiations process with the utilities, we did feel like that to make this decision would be one that would require that higher threshold of votes from 7 votes majority to 9 votes.
So rather than being a procedural decision, this was one that was made as part of the negotiation to up the ante to 9 instead of 7.
It was as part of the negotiations process.
So if we brought it back down to 7, I'm not proposing doing that at this point, but if we did bring it back down to 7, that would be an amendment to the term sheet as opposed to a city practice.
And I can answer that as well. Yes.
Okay.
So this was actually a point that came up that I think both, I'm not sure, one or both of the utility companies thought this was important. And I think it was a point of negotiation. So if we were to change that, we'd have to go back then and renegotiate the terms. I see another question. Councilmember Connell.
Thank you, Chairman Gordon. So thank you to all the staff and all the other community, actually partners that are on this PowerPoint today. But I also want to acknowledge the community who has been one of the critical participants of bringing the negotiations and bringing that fertile ground forward to allow us to have those discussions. And I know that a lot of the folks in the room are here today, and I want to applaud your efforts and thank you for speaking up and staying consistent and staying dedicated to engaging community members through house parties, rallies, engaging in a lot of the political campaigns to raise awareness about this very important issue. So with that, I do have a question about what's the overall budget to continue to support this type of work? Specifically, as I'm looking at some of the language in the RCA, we talk about relying on the advisory group for some research or some, you know, information, vetting perhaps some of the data or recommendations coming from the board. Is there a specific number that we're thinking about in terms of how we continue to sustain the efforts of this particular discussion in relationship to our racial equity work and to the environmental justice community?
Chair Gordon, Councilmember Cano, presently as part of the mayor's proposed budget, there is $150,000 dedicated towards the support of this effort. I would also say that, you know, that the city, the utilities will be in a better position next year once that board has had an opportunity to meet, identify a 2-year work plan, to more explicitly identify what additional resources the city might bring to bear. And I'm not in position to say what resources Xcel Energy or CenterPoint Energy are looking to bring to this effort. I just know that you know, they've definitely have strong commitments towards the board and the board's work. And so I think that'll become more clear next year and the years that follow.
Would members from Xcel Energy or CenterPoint be interested in coming up to address that question? Resources moving forward? Just kind of what you're thinking?
So I think that what we would like to do is give them an opportunity to speak once we open the public hearing. That's kind of what the attorney has said. We open the public hearing, and then if they want to make that part of the comments, that would be great.
That would be great. And one last question. So I understand this is our sort of plan A. You know, we're hoping that things will work out and we're hoping that everyone will get along and move towards our goals. What are our plans for developing alternative routes to achieving a more sustainable energy vision? Do you has the team put together any thoughts about similar plans that would follow other tracks in relationship to perhaps if the utilities don't meet our goals, then what do we have to fall back on when, if those things don't move as progressively as we'd like?
Chair Gordon, Councilmember Cano, frankly, our efforts have largely focused on trying to reach the greatest agreement possible with Xcel Energy and CenterPoint Energy. If down the road there's a situation where that partnership is not bearing fruit, I think that the city does need to invest some significant time in exploring other options. I know that there's, you know, other options that have been considered last year and other options that are potentially out on the table, but our energy has been focused on what we can do with our utility partners.
Thank you. Councilmember Bender.
Thank you, Mr. Chair. I think this is such an exciting step forward for us. And I think one of the things that's so important about this is the advisory committee, which is going to have, you know, be the mechanism by which the community voices can stay at the table. And we do have that represented in the memorandums of understanding that there will be an advisory committee, but the language about who's on the committee is pretty vague at this point, which I think is okay. The board will have representation by the city who can make sure that we have people at the table. But I just wondered if you could talk more about kind of the choice to leave that membership of that advisory committee open at this point, and then how we can expect, you know, to get that committee formed.
Chair Gordon, Councilmember Bender, a couple things on the committee itself. A couple items led to us not getting down to the specifics. So one of them was time. You know, our interest was trying to get an agreement in place by the end of October, and so that the Minnesota Public Utilities Commission process could begin so that we could have these plans in place ultimately by the first of the year. So that we, as negotiations team, we decided to focus our efforts on those things that could get us to an agreement. We also felt similar to the project work, rather than saying, exactly, these are the types of projects we want to work on in the next 2 years, that for the advisory committee itself, that we felt that the board would be in the best position, that there was equal representation between the city and the utilities, that they would use their good judgment to come up with a advisory committee that was well representative of all the community interests, and that we wanted to leave some of that work to them versus keep it in the hands of the negotiation committee.
I'll just note that it also might be helpful if people have comments about that, just if we could hear them. So part of it was, I think we wanted to be able to take the time to make sure that we had the advisory group, with all the stakeholders there, or a mix that would have broad support.
Yeah, I'll just note, I mean, there seems to be one advantage too, which would be that rather than cementing it in the MOU, it allows for more flexibility over time if the board chooses to add people or change the makeup of the committee. So I'm comfortable, but I thank you for the explanation.
All right, thank you very much. I don't see any other questions, so I think we can conclude the presentation for now, and there might be some later. And I'm going to open the public hearing, and we decided that it might make the most sense to let the utility companies come up first, just so that everybody could kind of understand if there is actually agreement or if there's some difference of opinion, and we could hear from them. And I'm going to, I guess, go maybe in alphabetical order and let Mr. Vorthrums come up first, and you can take however much time you need. I think generally we're going to ask people to keep it to about 3 minutes, but if you want to go a little above that, that's okay.
Good afternoon, Chairman Gordon and members of the committee. My name is Joe Vorthrums. I'm the Vice President of Gas Operations in Minnesota for CenterPoint Energy. We're located downtown. We have our offices in the LaSalle Plaza, but we are in the process of moving to 505 Nicollet Mall, the old Neiman Marcus building. And as part of our move, we're actually taking the opportunity to upgrade that facility to a LEED Silver certification from a efficiency and environmental friendliness perspective. Thanks for the opportunity to give you our thoughts about the franchise renewal and the clean energy partnership. We've had the opportunity to work with the city staff and energy advocacy committees over the last several months to get, and they've allowed us to get us to know each other better and develop an improved working relationship across the board. The process, I think, brought to us a franchise agreement and a clean energy partnership that is highly innovative and overall just a very good product for all involved. We understand that the hard work is just starting now. Again, the product I think is very good, but we are gonna be working with the city to help them achieve their greenhouse gas emissions reduction goals through the Clean Energy Partnership over the next 10 years, and we're looking forward to being a part of that. CenterPoint Energy has an extremely robust and effective conservation improvement program. It's been in place for years, and we know firsthand that these opportunities help residents and businesses lower their energy consumption and associated greenhouse gas emissions. We're very proud of our conservation improvement program. In fact, as recently as last week, we've received the Demand Side Management Achievement Award from the eSource organization for achieving the most energy savings in the nation as a percent of retail sales for any gas utility. With these types of programs and the efforts, we're excited to see how the Clean Energy Partnership will create new opportunities to work together to accomplish even more. And as a way of wrapping up, I'd also like to thank everyone that was involved to get us where we are today. In addition to Councilmember Gordon, Council Vice President Glidden, and the members of the committee, as well as members of the staff, and I would echo Mr. Strobel was extremely effective in getting us together. It was sort of herding cats at times, but he did an excellent job of making sure it was a fair product. And I think his main goal too was making sure everyone was comfortable with where we were going. I'd also like to acknowledge the broader community and energy advocacy groups that helped and encouraged us to be innovative and bring together a collaborative product. From my perspective, it was a collaborative effort and the willingness of everyone involved to bring together a workable solution, and I believe that is a product that is very good. Chairman Gordon and Councilmember Camo, to address the resources item that you had brought up, again, CenterPoint Energy does have a highly robust conservation improvement program. We spend approximately $25 million every year on our conservation improvement programs. In addition to that, I would refer to Mr. Strobel's comment that we'll, as we go through this, we can revisit and reanalyze the resources necessary to achieve what we have. Thank you.
Thank you very much. Excel, I'd like Excel Energy to have an opportunity. Ms. McCartan, welcome.
Good afternoon, Chair Gordon, members of the committee. Thank you very much. I am Laura McCartan. I am Regional Vice President of State Affairs with Xcel Energy, and very much appreciate the opportunity to address you here today about these proposed agreements, the franchise renewal and the clean energy agreement. Both the city and Xcel Energy brought to the negotiating process a sincere desire to reach an outcome that would help the city achieve its goals and that would also be sustainable over the long term for all the parties involved. And for that, I want to extend my thanks and on behalf of my company for the guidance and leadership, Chair Gordon, Council Vice Chair Glidden, Council Chair Johnson, and the mayor provided to this process as we worked on it. And also, I'd like to acknowledge those folks from the city that represented the city that we worked directly with. Jay Strobel was great. You actually had a great team. Jay Strobel, Peter Ginder, your CFO, Kevin Carpenter, and the mayor's policy aide, Stephanie Zawistowski. Also, I'd like to acknowledge the contributions of Mike Bull and Sheldon Strom from Center for Energy and Environment. Truly, they played a critical role in getting us to this important point. Negotiating important issues isn't easy, shouldn't be easy, but the negotiations on this agreement and all of these agreements were always conducted in a very respectful and productive manner. And I think that the teams from both organizations worked really hard to understand each other's positions and needs. And from that, as a result, we at Xcel Energy did gain a greater insight into the city's interests, motivations, your aspirations, and your day-to-day constraints. And I believe the city gained similar insights into our business as well. I know this mutual understanding will only grow as we work together under these proposed agreements. And from this, we'll leverage our separate strengths to build creative and innovative ways to, again, keep working on helping the city meet its goals. Over the years, our business has evolved as our customers' needs have changed, as energy policy has changed, and in concert with the broader community of those who are interested in energy issues and those who represent folks across the board. Our mission is to be the preferred and trusted provider of our customers' energy needs. And we know to achieve that, we must provide safe, reliable, reasonably priced, and increasingly clean energy to our customers. Today, over half of our energy sources are carbon-free energy. Today and for the last 10 years, we have been the number one wind provider in the country. And over the last 30 years, we've developed a nation-leading portfolio of energy conservation programs that can help every single type of customer, from a homeowner to a large business, to manage energy more efficiently and to manage their monthly utility bills. We also have renewable energy programs that all of our customers can choose to be able to use more, have a greater reliance and use more renewable energy such as wind and solar. And overall, we're on track to reduce our carbon emissions 30% by the year 2020. Xcel Energy and Minneapolis have always had a great partnership on many levels, and under these proposed agreements, I look forward to working together to build an even stronger and more productive relationship, extending from the nuts and bolts of our day-to-day interfaces to the longer-term, more innovative initiatives and transformational initiatives. Minneapolis is our headquarters city. We are looking forward in 2016 to the completion of our new office building, which will be a LEED Silver certified building. It will be on Nicollet Mall between 4th and 5th Street. We have approximately 2,500 employees that work in the city of Minneapolis, and they individually give of their time and their United Way contributions to help build a stronger community. The Clean Energy Partnership Agreement, as well as the renewed franchise agreements before you today, it's an exciting step in the ongoing evolution of our business and what cities as unique customers need and expect from their energy partners. We're starting from a very strong foundation. We've already begun the work on this, and we're very much looking forward to working together under the structure of these new proposed agreements. So thank you very much. And Councilmember Cano, to your question, Joe Vortherms noted, we also have very robust energy conservation programs. It's on the order, I may not have the exact number, but we'll get it to you, but something like $80 million a year is for all of Xcel Energy in the state of Minnesota, and we will be relying on our very strong marketing department as well as other parts of our company to come together to work on developing these work plans and identify what that really takes to accomplish. But that's the sort of resources and commitment that we're bringing to the table on this.
Thank you very much.
Thank you.
I then have a 10 people who've already signed up, and there's still opportunities to sign up with the clerk if you'd like to sign up to speak. Also, afterwards, if you decide you want to speak at the last minute, as long as the public hearing's open, you can have a chance to speak then as well. So I'm going to go through the list here, ask people to keep their comments to about 3 minutes, and I think we'll have a timer. And the first person on the list is Betty Tissel. Tissel. Welcome, and it's tradition here to state your name and address to make sure it's pronounced correctly and for the record.
Thank you. Good afternoon. My name is Betty Tissel. I live at 4155 Garfield in the 8th Ward. Thank you so much for the chance to speak today. Last Wednesday, on the way to school, my 17-year-old noticed that twinkle lights have been installed on trees along Lindale near Lake Street. "Mom," she asked, "why don't we ban lights like that to save energy?" She and her friends are very concerned about climate change. They recognize that business as usual is not going to lead to a future they can optimistically look forward to. It's for them and all kids that we must work to achieve the city's energy goals. I'm encouraged by the progress towards a clean energy partnership. I urge the City Council to pass the partnership and the utilities to sign on as quickly as possible. It looks like the new agreements would function for a minimum of 5 years and a maximum of 10. Please keep the agreements as short as possible in order to have flexibility in the event of new technologies, lowered cost of renewables, or new challenges brought about by climate change. The Clean Energy Partnership Memorandum proposes that its new board should meet at least quarterly. I'm hoping that they'll meet bi-monthly and include input from the advisory group at every meeting. The memorandum draft lists possible members for the advisory group, to which I would add specifically renters, senior citizens, and youth. The Center for Earth, Energy, and Democracy reports that more than half of Minneapolis's housing is occupied by renters concentrated in communities of color and low-income neighborhoods. Seniors I've spoken with are concerned about affordability, and youth about avoiding the kind of climate future depicted in the dystopian novels they're reading. I ask the new board to implement changes and benefits equitably. Please track how benefits are being used across neighborhoods and in each ward. My Kingfield family is lucky to have 4 kilowatts of solar on our home. I checked my phone right before the hearing. Right now we are generating 4,453 watts while using 423. That means that on a beautiful day like today, we're generating 10 times the electricity we're using. Our project was possible only because we had the ready cash for down payments. Renewable energy should not be a luxury for the few. So, let's move quickly towards passage and equitable implementation of the franchise agreements and clean energy partnership. Thank you so much for the chance to speak today.
Thank you so much for being here yourself. Appreciate that. The next speaker on the list, I believe, is John Farrell. Unless you are, there was a little mark here, so Tim Springer. And Mr. Farrell, did you want to speak later? Okay. Tim, welcome. You can state your name and address for the record.
My name is Tim Springer. I live at 2836 18th Avenue South. Thank you, Chair Gordon and committee members, for conducting a hearing on this topic today and allowing us to share our thoughts. I'm here as an interested individual and also as a board member for a nonprofit organization called Community Power. We are the umbrella organization that grew out of and above Minneapolis Energy Options, which was so active last year in this discussion. Our mission is to educate and activate the residents of Minnesota cities and towns to create clean, local, equitable, affordable, and reliable energy systems. So thank you for the Climate Action Plan. Thank you for your energy vision. Thank you for the Energy Pathway Study. And thank you very much for bringing to this point the proposed city utility clean energy partnership. And thank you also to Xcel Energy and CenterPoint Energy for your work in getting us to this point. I personally am very excited about the city's longer term goal of an 80% reduction of greenhouse gas emissions by 2040, which is, of course, a big challenge and will require all hands on deck. Regarding the why this is important, our mission states what we think is important to try and achieve: clean, local, equitable, affordable, and reliable energy. I believe that the two biggest challenges of our time are climate change and social equity. So I'm going to share a couple thoughts just on the equity issue. Regarding climate change and impacts related to health, weather and disasters, habitat loss, and economic stress, every corner of Africa is already impacted far more greatly than North America. And by 2030, it will be even more extreme. But yet, on a per capita basis, they're not the culprits, we are. So we have a job to do. Right here at home, in terms of urban heat islands and who's impacted, in terms of household budgets going to pay for energy, where in the United States, low-income households pay about 15% of their household income for energy, and high-income households pay about 10. There are many reasons why the equity issue is addressed and important to address through energy issues. And not to mention the opportunity for jobs creation and local economic development that will help our urban core. So I'm very pleased and excited. We all are very pleased and excited. Please recognize that This is, of course, just a start. We'll be active participants in the process, and don't let us down. Thank you.
Thank you very much. Mr. Farrell, did you want to speak next?
Thank you, Chairman Gordon and members of the committee. Thank you to everybody who's been involved in this process. I am John Farrell. I live at 5533 Portland Avenue in Minneapolis, but I'm here on behalf of the Institute for Local Self-Reliance, located in the Seward neighborhood, where we do research on energy policy and for local economic development. I want to speak first of all to just the enormous historic opportunity that we have here. It's been mentioned any number of times already this morning that this is, or this afternoon, that this is a historic opportunity. This is a novel partnership between a city and a utility. And I give great credit to all of you for your hard work in making this happen and to the utilities to come together to create this opportunity for meaningful, grassroots-driven energy change and one that can help the city meet its sustainability and its climate vision. Just a sense of that potential, we actually, the Institute for Local Self-Reliance just published this morning a model, an energy model for the city of Minneapolis that we hope will be informative to this process, that this partnership, in terms of what the potential is for particularly developing a low carbon electricity sector for the city. It's based on a microgrid modeling system called HOMER that is produced and maintained by the National Renewable Energy Laboratory. And the idea is essentially, it's a very conservative way to model an energy system for a city because it assumes that you have no interconnection with the greater world, no way to share energy with your neighbors, which of course we can and will be doing. But it gives us a chance to see, well, if we started from ground zero and we just built the energy system that we thought was most appropriate, how much would it cost and what could we accomplish? And what we discovered that is that there are significant opportunities to increase renewable energy, to substantially decrease greenhouse gas emissions, and to do it at a comparable cost to the energy that we currently pay for from our electricity system. And I say that not as a criticism of our current electricity system, which took a long time to build out and has many historic reasons for being structured the way it is, but merely to highlight the opportunity that we have to take advantage of this partnership to work with our utilities to change that system to reach our goals. So that report, as I mentioned, was released this morning. It's available on our website, ilsr.org, and I hope it's just one piece that can be useful in terms of the conversation about this energy partnership and what it can accomplish. I secondly am here as a citizen of the city of Minneapolis and wanted to second comments that have already been made about the enormous opportunity. I think the Center for Earth, Energy and Democracy has done some terrific work about the implications of this opportunity for community involvement to lead to a more equitable energy system. I think we have both a moral and an economic imperative here to not only help those who struggle more strongly with the cost of our energy system, but also because there's more economic opportunity in finding ways to lower their energy costs to let them participate in our energy economy. So I thank you very much for all your hard work and look forward to seeing what we come up with.
Thank you very much for being here and for all your work. And at least two of us already have the report opened up here at our desk, so thanks for pointing us in that direction. Next is George Crocker. And following George is John Kolstad, just to give people a chance to get ready.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman, members. My name is George Crocker. I'm the executive director of the North American Water Office, which is based in Lake Elmo. But for the last 3 years, I've sort of been on the point of bringing Minneapolis Energy Options Community Power, working with colleagues to bring this whole opportunity forward. So I'm very pleased to have this opportunity to talk with you. For more than 30 years, I've been intervened in a wide variety of decision-making before the state agencies, before courts, before the legislature. And my purpose in those interventions was to help decision makers be more responsible for the public's interest in conservation, renewable energy, and economic benefits for local communities. We've had some marginal success, but in terms of environmental protection and economic democracy from managing the energy we all consume, we fail utterly to date. The obsolete polluting power plants are still online. Mercury contamination, asthma from the fine particulate. If you look at the proper sets of data, cancers from the reactors. acidification is coming back. Economic disparities grow and rip the fabric of our society, and unabated climate chaos deeply undermines the foundation of civilization as we know it. All this destruction accelerates while we continue to reward the pollution and supply waste and simply waste over half of all of the energy we consume because we use such inefficient devices. How can this be? It's because the conventional decision makers are all on the same energy management team. Whether they operate the system like Excel people, or regulate it like the PUC, or make laws about it, they're all on the same team. They all have a vested interest in investments sunk into the technologies that cause the problems. By their nature, they protect those investments, even when our planet dissolves while it crashes and burns. But with this partnership, you are breaking that mold. You present competition not between obsolete and modern technologies, but between managers who serve vested economic interests and managers who represent the people. For that, you give us hope. But know this, we understand in detail the misbehaviors that allow power company managers to maintain their privilege and continue the abuse. And we know how easy it would be for this partnership to turn into a quarterly meeting for coffee. We will not let that happen. These utilities have said repeatedly to you, to the legislature, to the PUC, and in many other public venues that they want to be the good energy partner for Minneapolis, and we applaud that. We know how a good energy partner should behave, and we intend to enforce that good behavior. So thank you, and thank you for giving us hope.
Thank you very much. John Kolstad. Welcome.
Hi. My name is John Kolstad. I've run a national business in Minneapolis for 34 years, located at 3820 East Lake Street for 22 years. Last year, I strongly supported the proposal to move to municipal power in Minneapolis. As a fiscal conservative businessman, I wanted to lower the cost, I wanted to have increased reliability and a faster return of power when there are outages that the citizens and businesses experience where there is municipal power. With municipal power, we would have input in, through our elected officials and have input into public power policy and in new projects that are coming up through hearings like this one, and thus allowing us to move more quickly to clean, renewable energy. We do not have a voice at this time with the current private utilities. Beyond the global issues that we all know about from the news, burning coal releases neurotoxins of mercury and radioactive elements into the atmosphere. The October 2004 Consumers Report states that mercury levels have increased 30% in the North Pacific. That's just in the last 20 years, and will rise 50% more, or maybe more than that even, by 2050. This is making the large fish like tuna a toxic thing to eat. However, I'm here today to say that I'm cautiously going to support this partnership agreement. I'm skeptical. Yet NSP, with all of its resources, like our ratepayers' funds that they get, and their in-place organization and structure, can move more quickly to alternative kinds of energy and to local generation and usage. I'm here to say that I want to give them a chance to perform and to be that good partner. In business, it's performance that counts. The city of Minneapolis must have concrete goals and aggressive timelines in this partnership agreement and move as rapidly as possible to renewable energy. And by the way, nuclear power is not renewable energy. How fast can we move to renewable energy? Well, Germany has done it. 50% of their power now is being generated just in the last 10 years from renewables. And this summer, one day, or a few days, they were generating 75% of their power from renewables. That's fantastic. Today, the technology has advanced enormously. For example, the new solar panels are three times as effective, more efficient, more productive than the ones that Germany started installing more than 10 years ago. Minneapolis could reach the same goal Germany did in 10 years in 5 years. Where will we generate this power? There are thousands of flat, rough commercial buildings in the city, including mine. There are parking lots, highways, freeways, streets, rail, light rail, railroad right-of-ways, and residents that have sun exposure to in their backyards or their carports or their garages. So let's move ahead with this agreement with the understanding that if the private utilities do not achieve our goals in a timely manner, either because they can't or because they won't, then it will be clear that we must form our own public utility and do it collectively ourselves. So we will all accept this offer of good partnership, but as somebody once said, I can't remember who, trust but verify. Folks, we have to be smarter than wine yeast. You know about wine yeast. You place it in a rich container of rich grape juice. It multiplies like crazy and kills itself off in its own waste. We are facing an imminent disaster. If we act now to use just the technology we already have, we can turn this global climate change around and end, which is the possible extinction of all life on this earth. Plus, we would have cheaper, more reliable, and healthier environment, that energy, and a healthier environment. So let's get going. I think we're not moving fast enough. Thank you.
Thank you very much. The next speaker, and I'm not sure if it's a group of speakers, but Sammy Ardito Rivera is next on my list. But perhaps, okay, we'll, and also Shalini Gupta, welcome.
Thank you, Chair Gordon and members of the council. My name is Shalini Gupta. I'm with the Center for Earth, Energy and Democracy.
And I'm Sammy Ardito Rivera, also with the Center for Earth, Energy and Democracy.
And we both live and work in Minneapolis in Ward 2.
We've been told you don't have to worry so much now about getting so close to the microphones.
Okay.
We have some new, a new system, I guess. So
okay,
just
great.
Relax and I think we'll be able to hear you fine.
Okay, sounds great. So the Center for Earth, Energy and Democracy, we are an environmental justice organization that is based in Southeast Minneapolis. We are an organization that is dedicated to ensuring that justice is a fundamental principle, guiding strategies for addressing climate change, environmental degradation, and long-term sustainability challenges. We provide our brief comments in support of the City Utility Partnership, and also in light of the following facts. Minneapolis is home to 46% people of color, including Latino population. About 22% of the Minneapolis community is below the poverty level. Over half of the residential housing is occupied by renters, which tend to be highly concentrated in communities of color and low-income neighborhoods. Households at or below the federal poverty level contribute 17%, nearly a fifth of their income to paying their energy bills. Even households with incomes between 150% and 185% of the poverty rate have energy bills that are above what is considered to be affordable. Energy bills are also cited as one cause of defaulting on mortgage payments. Due to these factors, community and energy justice advocates within the Minneapolis Community Environmental Advisory Commission and those that were involved with the Environmental Justice Working Group to the Minneapolis Climate Action Plan back in 2013 insisted that the city include in its adopted energy vision that in 2040, quote, Minneapolis's energy system will contribute also to a more socially just community. Given these statistics and the related racial health and economic disparities in Minneapolis that we are collectively working to eradicate, we must ensure that the potential energy cost and local job benefits of energy efficiency and renewables, such as solar, are actualized for all Minneapolis residents and businesses, particularly and especially those communities that are currently over-energy burdened. The possibilities of contributing to economic and racial equity in Minneapolis of this clean energy partnership are exciting, promising, and necessary, but will only be realized by one, a focused and stated commitment by the board of the Clean Energy Partnership that will address energy equity as a key priority in its implementation, Two, that the Energy Vision Advisory Committee has strong multiple, not just one, but multiple seats for environmental justice experts, renter advocates, and those with specific knowledge of energy poverty issues. And three, that transparency in decision-making and accountability and tracking of how the benefits of the Clean Energy Partnership are being distributed across our neighborhoods. We are very excited about this opportunity moving forward and look forward to future discussions. Thank you.
Thank you very much. Next is Timothy Den Herder Thomas. Welcome.
Good afternoon and thank you. My name is Timothy Denver Thomas. I live at 3100 Longfellow Avenue in the 9th Ward. I'm also part of the Community Power team. I want to thank the city and Excel and Centerpoint for all of their work coming together on creating this partnership, and I believe that this is a good next step, and also that this is only a first step. I want to speak briefly to some of the possibilities, definitely not all of them because I don't have time, but some of the possibilities that I think we could be seeing in the next years here in Minneapolis if we really take this partnership and use it to its full potential. When I look at the future, I see a energy system where we're using the on-bill financing law that was authorized at the state level last year, and linking the connections and resources that the city and the utilities have to find financing sources so that anyone in the city, regardless of their income, regardless of their property ownership status, can access funds to improve efficiency in their homes, solar, other types of renewable energy technologies, and pay that off on their utility bill using the savings that it creates so that people don't have to worry about an additional cost burden from clean energy and energy efficiency. I'm looking at and imagining and currently talking with various partners about how could we launch neighborhood by neighborhood community energy campaigns where we are going, block to block, neighborhood by neighborhood, and getting people as neighbors and as communities signed up for efficiency improvements and clean energy improvements, and using that economy of scale and coordinated process and multilingual outreach to really make this possible for everyone and having a parallel track for that in the business community. I'm looking for a future where we have easy access to community ownership of solar, for everyone, that it's actually a strategy that can be cheaper and more affordable than our current energy sources. And looking at how can we modernize our technology and our grid with microgrid technology and smart grid technology so that our city is more resilient and ready to withstand the increasing shocks that we're likely to see as the weather gets more and more severe. This partnership is a first step, and now the real work begins. It's time to make this partnership something real, something that will work. I want us to work together, the city, communities, and the utilities, to show the state and the nation and the world what's possible when utilities step up to clean, local, equitable, affordable, and reliable energy. When a city steps up with visionary leadership to both push this process and sustain it, and when communities step up so that we can begin the real work of creating the energy system of our dreams. Thank you.
Thank you. Next is Lee Samuelson. Welcome.
Yeah, Lee Samuelson. I'm at 2836 18th Avenue South. And on behalf of Community Power, I'm here to speak in favor of City Council passing the MOU Clean Energy Partnership. From my experience going to numerous gatherings with these cards in hand, I can attest that your constituents are excited by both utilities' recent statements seeking a partnership with Minneapolis, because now is the time to turn these statements into action. I present the 499 cards to Excel, and 299 cards to CenterPoint in favor of signing on to the partnership agreement to demonstrate accountability and share control as partners advancing the city's energy goals, such as the 2040 Energy Vision Statement and the Climate Action Plan goal of 10% local renewable energy by 2025. And because we believe that community input is so essential for keeping the partnership dynamic, open, and accountable, the second ask on our cards is for all parties to, reading from the card here, support a robust energy vision advisory committee composed of community stakeholders with real power to prioritize and implement specific energy actions in the city, which, if I may add, was specified on page 52 of the Energy Pathways study and on recital number 5 of this partnership document. We are, the message that we hear from constituents is that we are hopeful that the City Utility Partnership will provide a launching pad for many innovative initiatives for, reading from the card here, enabling public participation, greater local control, and community benefit through a clean and efficient energy future. The final point we're asking Xcel and CenterPoint Energy is to, once again, reading from this card, work with the City of Minneapolis and community organizations to advance state legislative changes that enable all Minnesota cities to advance clean energy, energy efficiency, and local economic goals through their franchise and other agreements. And since last year, we have witnessed a great number of people expressed excitement about this opportunity for Minneapolis to become a microcosm for energy democracy that has inspired community power to hold dozens of community education events. And we hope this partnership similarly engages the community. And I do see an opening to connect this community engagement to the transition town conversations and the peak oil discussions, which add a whole new level of urgency for our work in building a resilient and sustainable energy system. And going forward, we will keep a close eye on the partnership so that it is meeting its stated goals. And overall, we're delighted to see Xcel and CenterPoint coming together with the city because what we hear from constituents, the city and the utilities can accomplish a lot more with saving energy by supplementing each other's assets rather than the ineffective status quo of working in isolation from each other. Thank you.
Thank you very much. And I'll also note that I got a stack of those cards as well and appreciated that. Next is Michelle Schroeder, and then after that, Nathan Blumenschein, and that's the last on the list that I have so far, and it looks like there's more coming.
Everybody, my name is Michelle Schroeder. I am off of Ridgewood Avenue. I'm in Councilmember Goodman's ward. I'm testifying as a citizen of Minneapolis, and I want to thank everybody here at the committee for allowing us testimony on this topic today. I believe that the multi-year discussions about the upcoming termination of the city's utility franchise agreements have been fruitful, and I would like to thank everybody who's been involved in this process. I'm not going to list everybody because they've been listed several times. I believe that the Clean Energy Partnership and the Energy Vision Advisory Committee is a commendable step forward. These create a better arrangement for meeting the city's energy objectives and reducing greenhouse gas emissions overall. I'd like to request that both the city and utilities look at those goals, those greenhouse gas reduction goals, as a base rather than as a ceiling. I ask that all parties try to be even more aggressive than the city's stated goals were possible. Regarding the franchise agreement terms, I think it's really good to shorten the term of the utility franchise agreements so that these issues are more regularly in front of parties than before. Regarding the term length of the franchise agreements, instead of the 10-year length with a 5-year opt-out, I would rather see a 5-year term with an easy renewal process to opt in to another 5-year agreement. I would prefer to see a conscious act by City Council to renew for a second 5-year term rather than having the renewal happen by default. Mr. Strobel spoke earlier saying that a vote of 2/3 needs to be taken. I think that should be flipped around. I think that the city should actually vote in favor of renewing a franchise agreement rather than having the 2/3 vote to opt out. Annual reports, I think, one of the reasons why I think that that's important to have, I think that we need to better accommodate
quicker policy and technology changes as they come up. We're in kind of a different era in that regard these days. Happy to be part of that, living during these times. Hang on a second here. There's one other thing that I wanted to say. The annual reports too, I'm happy to see that that's in there. I think that's gonna be really good for us to be able to review the relationship between the city and the utilities and how that progresses. And it gives us an opportunity to be able to have input, even just as a citizen. So that's it for me. I wanted to keep it short. Thanks, everybody.
Thank you very much. Nathan Moonshine, welcome.
Thank you. I'm Nathan Blumenschein, 3156 Elliott Avenue South. I'd just like to start by saying that I support all the efforts of Community Power, and I would urge the City Council as well as the utilities to sign on to the agreements that we have before us today. Just sitting here and looking at the City Council, I can't help but think how awesome it is to have a group of people that know how serious climate change is in the seats of power in the city. So I thank you all for being awesome. And just hearing Councilmember Fry's question and Councilmember Cano's question about how we need to have some teeth in terms of working with and negotiating with our corporate neighbors, I can tell that you guys all get it and that you're 100% with us in addressing climate change. So thank you very much. I'd also really like to thank the utilities here today and just for the clean energy partnership that's been put together and your willingness to come to the table and negotiate with members of the community and the city. I can tell that you also are taking climate change seriously. Maybe not 100%, but 80, 85%, you're getting there, and that's really awesome. And I'm really excited to move forward to 100% understanding how important it is that we take this issue seriously. I'd just like to echo Mr. Crocker's concerns about corporate behavior in the past, and how there have been many times where communities have come together to ask corporations to take environmental issues seriously. And we've been met with great opportunities to have conversations. And then we still repeatedly end up with environmental problems. However, I hope and I believe that this partnership can be something that changes that path and can be something that we can use for successful change in the future. The last time that I was here testifying during the Minneapolis Energy Options effort, the utilities and the community were kind of on different sides of an issue. And today it is so awesome to hear that everybody is ready to accept this agreement and that we're all on the same team. Today we are committing to be part of the same team that takes climate change seriously. And I hope that we all give more than 100% in the future to make it successful. So thank you, everyone, for being here.
Thank you. And the next speaker is Dylan Kesty, Dylan Bradford Kesty. And then Marcus Mills is next.
Dylan Bradford Kesty, 740 East 16th Street. Good afternoon, Chair Gordon and committee members. Thank you so much for this opportunity. Thank you for hearing all of us. And I would also echo that we fully support you signing this agreement. And I'd thank the utilities for also putting in all the work over the last couple of years to make this happen. So thank you for all of your time. I'm Dylan Bradford Kesty, and I just really wanted to echo that it has been years in the making. It's been years of valued community members getting together, council members putting in time last year of helping guide this work, Minneapolis Energy Options, Community Power, all of us are now here today. And I thank you all sincerely for making this an opportunity. Today's an exciting opportunity for the City of Minneapolis to move forward on equity, energy, and environmental goals as we discuss establishing a first-of-its-kind city utility clean energy partnership. Committee members, I thank you as you were integral in making this partnership happen today. The goals of the partnership are making energy affordable and reliable for everyone while increasing energy efficiency, increasing renewable energy, and reducing greenhouse gases mirrors that of the campaign last year, Minneapolis Energy Options. Last year, I had the honor of working with you all, our community, and as the campaign manager of the Minneapolis Energy Options campaign. It's exciting to see the hard work of so many community members and the dreams of thousands of supporters coming to fruition today as we seize this real opportunity for community engagement and a local focus on cleaner, equitable, affordable, and reliable energy system in the city of Minneapolis. This is a great step forward. But I would remind you, as others have, this is just a step. This is one step on a very long road to clean, affordable, reliable, and local energy future for all. I know that Minneapolis Energy Options and Community Power look forward to working with the city and the corporate power companies in the partnership, working to build bridges to a more sustainable and equitable future for all. As we move forward, I would remind the utilities that we will be watching. During the campaign last year, Xcel Energy in particular claimed that they are the best partner for our city's energy future. I would say, Xcel Energy, you have that chance to prove it now. Prove to Minneapolis ratepayers seeing continued rate increases to fund outdated and polluted technology. Prove it to local clean energy developers and installers and invest in local clean and green jobs in our community. Prove it to future generations as you move forward on clean, affordable, reliable, and local energy in Minneapolis. We will be watching you, and we will be keeping our options open. Thank you for your time. Thank you, council members, and thank you, Fertilities. And let's move this forward. Have a good day.
Thank you very much. Marcus Mills is next. And then Sean Grachowski.
Thank you, Chair Gordon, and thank you, members of the committee. Some of you may, my name is Marcus Mills. I'm, my address is 309 6th Street Southeast. I am in Ward 3, and some of you may know me from several organizations I'm a part of and work with. But first, in the interest of due diligence, I will state that I speak today only for myself, and that I represent only those of like opinion. Voicing that opinion, I say, this is a positive start. Not a goal attained, but a smart compromise. In other words, it is not a completion, not a moment where we, the people of Minneapolis, can afford to rest on our laurels, but merely a beginning, a groundbreaking one, but a beginning nonetheless. Some very important matters brought us to this point. Matters of concern, such as community power, municipalization, renewable energy, climate change, and personal choice in the energy market. And while I support this step and believe that it could be a major movement in the right direction, there is still the possibility that this compromise could prove unfavorable to the interests of those who have driven the conversation, our neighbors. Let us not forget that up until this moment, our city signed 20-year agreements that allowed energy companies to rule our local energy markets as oligarchs, or if we are to uphold the jurisprudence of the last 130 years and believe that corporations are people unto themselves, we must think of them as dictators. And while this compromise brings us closer to the position of, shall we say, a constitutional monarchy, in the metaphor of energy city-states, I for one, and I doubt I stand alone, will always be striving to bring my neighbors energy democracy. And so, while we can confidently say that the partners will be sure to look out for their own interests, as well as some of ours, in the twin enthusiasms of support and vigilance, I promise that I, and if I have anything to say about it, Minneapolis, will be watching to make sure that this partnership works for the betterment of the city's communities, the renewable energy future of Minneapolis, as well as the economic, health, and environmental well-being of both the constituents of the city and the consumers of the utilities. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much. Welcome.
Okay. Hi, Sean. I'm Sean Grachowski, the director of the Alliance for Sustainability, and I live in Laundress Ward with right by the Midtown Y there, 3132 22nd Avenue South. And Minneapolis adopting the Climate Action Plan has been a leader in the Twin Cities, and it's exciting that the whole Met Council has also adopted the state's goal of achieving an 80% carbon reduction. So I think as the Clean Energy Partnership moves forward in Minneapolis, I hope that we can also find ways of helping the entire metro area to move in this direction. I was fortunate to go to the National League of Cities event a couple weeks ago, where we had about a dozen cities in the Midwest, like Burnsville and St. Louis Park, that are also committed to moving in this direction. And Hennepin County also had staff there, and they also are really excited about moving, trying to help other cities in the metro to achieve both carbon reduction as well as climate adaptation as well. I'm also just wanting to let you know that residents and people we work with are motivated to go toward carbon neutrality. Like Mayflower United Church of Christ is committed to becoming carbon neutral with their building. We also have businesses like the Kim Bartman's restaurants. The Tiny Diner is such an awesome place with a huge solar panel. And as well as the neighborhood groups are very committed to this. Longfellow will be having an energy forum on February 6th for a couple hundred residents in South Minneapolis over at Holy Trinity Lutheran. So one of the things that's really needed is to find ways of really mobilizing all of our neighborhood groups, as well as apartment dwellers and businesses. So one opportunity to do that will be the Citywide Community Connections Conference is coming up on March 20th, where the city rents the convention center. So they have the folks organizing a conference have agreed to have resilience and sustainability as one of the tracks for this year. So we'd like to work with you on how to have opportunities from the utilities to be highlighted at the neighborhood conference in March. Another issue is how to engage low-income neighbors in an understanding how to save energy as well as reduce climate impacts. For example, with hotter days, are people in apartment buildings gonna have access to good air conditioners if we have heat waves and things? So how can we try to work with low-income residents to be more climate resilient? On my block, we have five apartment buildings owned by Steve Friends, who owns a couple hundred buildings in the city. And so Alondra has met with inspections department to help try to get more energy efficient ideas into Steve Friends. But we really need help with both CenterPoint and Excel to figure out new ways of achieving multifamily efficiency, both in terms of electricity and natural gas use. Another issue is all the new construction happening in our city. If we can move in the direction of what they're doing in Germany with super efficient buildings, that'll make it much better for both really hot days as well as really cold days as well. And so the Corcoran neighborhood is trying to find out how can we find new financing mechanisms so that the private developments at High Lake can be, you know, up to a higher standard of efficiency. And then finally, the city of Minneapolis and Hennepin County are really working very well with this new equity partnership where John Powell came to town just a couple weeks ago. And so we're excited about the Viking Stadium having 30% of the work being done by minority contractors. So let's try to bring the same momentum in terms of training crews and neighborhoods to do weatherization, training crews to work on solar installation, as well as maybe even looking at Excel and CenterPoint, hiring more folks for their utility crews to find out how we can have more neighborhood folks getting high paid jobs to work on this energy transition. So thanks so much for the energy partnership, and the Alliance for Sustainability is willing to work with you all on how to mobilize neighborhoods working with all of our environmental justice partners and the neighborhood groups that we work with. So thanks.
Well, thank you. I appreciate that. The last speaker that signed up is Marlena Needham. And then is there anyone else who wants to speak after this? Could you raise your hands just so that we know? It looks like there isn't one person. Okay, so we'll have one more speaker after this.
Hello. My name is Marlena Needham, and I'm here on behalf of Community Power. I live at 3100 Longfellow in Minneapolis, Minnesota, and I live in the Corcoran neighborhood. Over the past year, I've been one of the facilitators for the Powerful Conversation Tour throughout Minneapolis and the surrounding cities. After speaking with a lot of people over the past year, it's become clear that a lot of people are increasingly concerned with climate change, and also that a lot of people feel really disempowered by the sheer weight of the change that needs to happen, and also because of the reality that in the past, we as a city haven't really had a lot of say in our energy grid. That being said, I'm really excited by the possibilities that this partnership represents. I know a lot of the results of the city utility partnership are dependent upon the groups and the people who come to the table. So for that reason, I'm in support of a diverse group of community stakeholders being a part of the conversations. Talking with people over the last few months, I didn't come across anybody who was against the city utility partnership, but I did run into some people who were a little bit skeptical, who thought that maybe this was just another ploy, and they thought maybe the utilities might be making empty promises. I think I speak for most of them when I say that I really hope that that's not the case. The last thing that I would like to say is that I'm in support of the shortest possible franchise agreement that we can sign. With the rate of advancing technology, we really don't know what's going to be on the market even next year, much less what's going to be on the market in 5 years. Not to mention all the smart grid technology that already exists. I know some of it's been said to be too expensive right now, but the same thing was said about wind and solar a couple years ago, and it's dropped in prices faster than anybody really could have predicted. So I'd really like to see us keep our options open. And also, the last thing, one of the other reasons I'm in support of a shorter franchise agreement is because I would like to see us revisiting our goals as a city as often as possible, which a shorter franchise agreement allows for. The last thing I'd like to say is thank you to the utilities for taking this amazing first step towards being a better partner to the city and its residents. Thank you.
Thank you very much. Now we have one more speaker. If you could come forward and state your name and address for the record. Welcome.
Thank you. My name is Leslie McKenzie. My address is 2852 35th Avenue South. I am so thankful that the city has a climate plan that demonstrates that we really understand the severity of the problem that we face. And I'm excited by this partnership as one step, a first step in a journey that we have to make fairly quickly, because we need to make great haste in arriving where we need to be. I would urge the council to look at the shortest possible agreement, but also one that has some clear milestones along the way, so we know that our partners have the same sense of urgency and willingness to move forward quickly. So I would encourage you to go with a 5-year plan. And I also have some concern about the supermajority as opposed to a simple majority vote. And I also would have a concern about the opting out rather than opting in. But I guess I'd leave that to you. I just express my concern that there needs, if we're not making the kind of progress that we need to be making, that we have a way to move forward in a different direction. But that said, I support this partnership and I hope that you will too.
Thank you very much. Last call for any final speakers. All right, one more. Well, as part of the public hearing, you can say anything you want, and if it's in the form of a question, it may just get answered. Just to warn you.
I'm Leah Fouché. I work with the North American Water Office, and I'd like to ask Xcel, Mr. Sparby, what portion of Minneapolis power is nuclear?
Well, if Mr. Sparby would like to answer that, that's fine with me.
NSP Minnesota has between 25% and 30% on average nuclear power.
Thank you.
Is that all?
I would suggest that we change that.
Okay. Thank you very much. So with that, I will close the public hearing. Thank everybody for coming and speaking. I have to say that many of you actually led us into this and through this. And so if everything goes well and we get somewhere really good in the end, it's all because of the great city council up here. But if it's a big flop, we'll remember who started it. Just kidding. Are there comments, Councilmember Johnson?
Thank you, Mr. Chair, and I want to definitely reiterate that message. You know, last week when we got our final briefing with the coordinator's office, we walked in and Jay Strobel said to us, thank you so much for talking about municipal energy last year and being out there. It's really enabled us to get this strong partnership. And that whole conversation really arose out of the efforts of many individuals in this room and Minneapolis Energy Options. And so know that we have a stronger partnership, and we're actually doing this partnership, I think, largely, if not entirely, as a result of the conversations that you sparked. So I think that that is huge, huge, huge. Of course, now is where the rubber meets the road around this, and we need to actually follow up and track and make sure that we're getting the outcomes we're looking for from this. And I also just want to share the technology, IT perspective that I have, because I think that that's so important here. You know, our last contract, 20 years old, in that amount of time, computing power has gotten 100 times faster, 100 times smaller, 10 times cheaper. So now we have these devices which are running on wireless technology that didn't even exist, which the technology before that didn't even exist 20 years ago. And now we have apps that are completely indispensable in our lives that we couldn't even dream up 20 years ago. And we are seeing this exponential development with technology. I mean, now we have 3D printers, which are going to revolutionize manufacturing. We have Amazon out there that's looking at delivering packages within an hour to your house by a drone. Google has cars in California that are self-driving around. We have incredible artificial intelligence. We have extremely sensitive, reactive robots. We're gonna have breakthroughs in genetics. I believe within even the next 10 years, it's possible that we're one battery breakthrough away from seeing the very last fossil fuel vehicle roll off the assembly line. And as part of this, we're gonna see a lot of change happening exponentially in the energy field. In fact, Michigan earlier this year, they had a breakthrough. They were able to develop solar panels that are transparent. And I wanna see the day that IDS Tower is covered in solar panels that are see-through and everyone just said, well, that's a window. But yeah, it produces energy, not just for this building, but for a large section of downtown. But today we actually have backup fossil fuel plants running. So we have a long ways to go. And this microgrid technology, this smart grid technology, that's the wave of the future. We know it's coming. We know there's not going to be business as usual. We know it's going to disrupt the industry. And I'm hoping that Xcel is really taking a leadership standpoint in that regard, helping to drive the development of this technology, helping residents finance it on their homes, helping connect people. So when my house produces an abundance of energy, it's able to share it easily with the neighbors. And right now, being able to enable our entrepreneurs, our innovators, our universities, our local businesses to help develop that technology, to contribute nationally, to develop the smart grid technology, the solar panels, and to be able to create jobs around developing a cleaner, brighter future for our city. So I really, really, really hope that we see that. I'm optimistic, I'm excited about this partnership, and we'll be watching closely. And just once again, thanks everyone who helped make this possible.
Thank you, Councilmember Glidden.
Thank you, Mr. Chair, and I have to say I'm just so stunned almost to be here at the moment when this is coming before this committee. If I would go back a certain point in time, I don't know that I envisioned that we would be able to get here. But I feel like we had an amazing coming together of the way I think we all play our roles sometimes in driving change with a very robust community engagement strategy led by energy options, but with many other community partners, institutional, neighborhood, individual. I mean, it really, I heard about this issue a lot. So that means folks are getting the word out and they're talking about how much they care about energy. Sometimes that seems like a hard sell, but I think that's really has been happening. I think it helped push us at the city council as well as push the utilities to think about a little differently about what should and could be possible. I think we made a good decision in the city at a key moment last year to invest in hiring a consultant, which turned out to be the Center for Energy Environment, to create the Energy Pathway Study. And I really want to thank Mike Ball for his work on that with other partners. But that was really an amazing piece of work. And it came about because the community was saying, we want to see what would happen with more options. And this was one way for us to lead down that path and see what that would look like. And in the end, I think that turned into the roadmap for the negotiations with the utility companies, with CenterPoint, with Excel, with some clear expectations laid out there about having a shorter agreement period, about having something that allowed us to work together on achieving our climate action goals and tying the franchise together with that work in partnership on the climate action goals. And having this recommendation come forward that includes also a community advisory committee, something that we're going to be able to really dig in and work on in the years to come. I feel really proud actually to have been here, and thank Councilmember Gordon for being such a great partner on this, as well as Council President Johnson and Council Member Lilligren, who was here last year, and all my colleagues here today who I know also were engaged in this issue even before they were on the City Council. And so that's the power of working together. And I haven't mentioned, there's been thanks before, but we have an extremely engaged and involved staff infrastructure in the city, from the folks in our sustainability office to the city coordinator, to our city attorneys, and just folks really dug in and said, how can we get the best result? Because it's really important that we do so, and all eyes are on us right now. And here we are with a First in Nation proposal that I'm excited to work on into the future. I know there's been some discussion about the termination clause, you know, I think it's good that we raise those questions about that. I will say the termination clause with the supermajority, it applies only during the period if you want an early termination with the agreement. So we have now set up a structure that allows us essentially, if this partnership is not working, a way to exit this agreement. And I think that's a serious option to take. Having 9 votes is something that also would make this something that that we would know that the mayor would support as well, because that's a veto-proof method forward. So just to talk about that a little bit. And sometimes you have to figure out what's important within the negotiation. And if you decide one thing is more important than another, then sometimes you're giving up other things. I think in total, this is a good collection of items. We do not need a supermajority to make a decision once we get to the end of this proposed agreement on whether or not we move forward together. So I will say that too. So that's also in that agreement. Councilmember Cano asked an interesting question about what would happen if we didn't have this existing agreement. And I actually think the groundwork for talking about that question is in this energy pathway study. And this is, again, what led us to working in this unique environment of having this companion piece to the franchise agreement of a clean energy partnership. And options are laid out, I think, in that energy pathway study, and I think it gives us some idea of there would need to continue to be some major changes for us to think about multiple other options, but we do have that ability to continue to work together on our energy future. So I'm really happy this is moving forward. I think it's a major accomplishment, and thank you to all who've been involved.
Well, thank you. I think I will move this forward for approval and let Councilmember Bender speak, and then I'll say a few more words.
Thank you, Mr. Chair. You know, we heard so many things about accountability, and I just wanted to briefly say that I think this is such a critically important issue that we came to this point because of the accountability that you all here and your partners in the community created through the last, through your powerful campaign in the last election cycle. And that the accountability has to come from all of us going forward together. The accountability comes from us as elected officials, but it also comes from the changes that I hope you'll continue to push for at the state level that we need to open up more options, not only for the city of Minneapolis, for municipalities across the state. And hopefully we'll never have to go down that road. You know, I'm optimistic that this is a great way forward, but we know that, as Councilmember Glidden said, that if we wanted to pursue any other roadways, we would need to make significant changes at the state. And that only comes from the collaboration that we saw to get this far. And, you know, and it comes in election cycles. It comes through through your continued involvement in the advisory committee and activism in your neighborhoods. And so, you know, and it also comes from having utility providers that are willing to be groundbreakers in Minneapolis, and to really show that they can come to the table with the innovation that they bring, with the resources that they bring, to help us move forward even faster than we could without them. So I'm optimistic about this and really grateful for all the work that my colleagues at Councilmembers Glidden and Gordon and everyone did to get us here. But just wanted to say that I'm deeply committed to that accountability piece, that that we expect to see quick movement. And that there are strong controls in place, not only at that four-year mark, but before then, in this agreement. And I think that's really important. So thank you.
Councilmember Fry.
Thank you, Mr. Chair, and thank you for your, as well as Councilmember Glidden's, leadership on this issue on the council. I know that a lot of this preceded even our terms in office. So all the work that was done beforehand, Mr. Strobel, I know, did a ton of work on the negotiating, as well as both utilities. Thank you. And the community, really, you know, we talk about energy options. We don't have leverage without a good chunk of oomph behind us. And you provided that oomph every step of the way here. I know I can only speak for myself, but I would not be voting for this unless it had a relatively short term. And we got that here. I think we were on something like a 20 or a 25-year term previously, so we're looking at one quarter of that right now, arguably one half of that, but you know, we do have the option to hold utilities and our entire city really accountable. So I think this is an excellent step here, and it we couldn't be here without any of you.
Thank you, Councilmember Cano.
Thank you, Mr. Chair. So I also wanted to thank both you and Councilmember Glidden for working so hard on this. I'm really proud to be a part of this committee and be a part of this council that takes these issues seriously. They're no longer a marginalized conversation, but something that we're looking at that has serious impacts for the future of our kids and certainly people living here today. So I do want to acknowledge Xcel Energy and CenterPoint for being a part of this. I'm a Derek Jensen supporter, and anybody in the environmental justice movement knows that he's a pretty strong voice for critiquing the individualized notion that we're going to stop the climate change conversation by, recycling that one plastic piece of container, or recycling that paper. But he really looks at the institutional component of this and the large scope and breadth of what it's going to take to really turn things around. And having Xcel and CenterPoint at the table is extremely vital, extremely important for our future. And I want this to succeed, and I want us to be able to demonstrate that we have the leadership that's in Germany and in other countries, that we have the talent, the community engagement support, the vision, and the heart to do this work. So thank you, everyone, for being here today. And just like the other council members on this committee, I'm deeply committed to seeing this move forward.
Well, thank you very much. And I am I'm very appreciative. This is, I think, a great turning point. I think I really valued the comments that people took the time to write and think about and come in and make. If you want to amplify, I noticed some of you had written comments. You can actually send those in, and then we can have a record of what you said, and it could be helpful to us. The Center for Environmental and Economic Justice, I've got their name wrong, but SEED, Democracy, thanks, Earth, Energy, Democracy, sent in their comments as well, and they had some very specific ideas. So as those specific ideas come in, we were taking some notes, but I encourage you to feel free to send those in. I actually found some of them quite moving also and thought-provoking, so that was very significant. I do think we're really at a point here where this could make a really big difference in the way things work, not only in Minneapolis, but even elsewhere. It's been referred to many times as a first of its kind, first in the nation, this kind of partnership here. I have to say that I think we're at a critical point. Probably the issue of our time is climate change. The industrial era has been destroying the planet. We have to turn around course. We have to change direction. We have to figure out a new way to do it. Technology is catching up, probably to allow us to do it, so it isn't kind of going back to that the Earth, Mother Earth, Father World I imagined when I was 15 that we would be the answer. Maybe there's a different answer, but we have to get there, and we have to get there quickly, or many, many people are going to suffer, and potentially every person is going to suffer, and there won't be a species of human beings left. So that's how significant it is. And every year that goes by when we're not turning that corner is worse. So I think there's a way we can probably turn the corner, and we can protect the economic interests of the people whose jobs and livelihoods are dependent on the current or the older system, but we kind of have to do that together. And there's a real potential here with this partnership to look at different ways to do things if we're doing it together. I happen to think that the way the state's structured about municipalization and monopoly control, it's probably wrong, and it doesn't really fit the future. And I think there are the way to get to some kind of a municipalization anyway, I think, would be in smaller little pieces. And this partnership might actually let the city someday own a solar farm, and we'll have an agreement so that we can get that energy here, and we actually have some energy. We produce enough now, maybe even to provide electricity for all our streetlights, and we can drive down going, that's clean energy from the solar farm that I own because I live in Minneapolis or whatever. So I think there's some real potential there. I really like that this was connected to our energy vision. So our energy vision isn't just one of those visions that's two sentences or one sentence. It's four pages, and it was done very thoughtfully. And that's the guiding document for the Pathways partnership group that's going to go forward, is how can we implement this vision. And I appreciate people who mentioned our climate action plan, too, because that's very significant. Yep, we could probably up the goals, especially as we see everyone else adopting them. Maybe they aren't high enough, but I think that's significant. And that's also going to be key to the success of this moving forward. I also appreciated that everybody said that we're going to be watching you. And I think that's really important. And we want you to have your eyes on us. But actually, we're going to need more than just watching if we're going to pull this off. So you're going to have to get actively involved and engaged. If there's a chance to sign up or go somewhere or show up or speak up, we're going to need that to be happening along the way so that we can get those ideas. Because there is this kind of inertia that can happen in a bureaucracy like city government, and probably in big corporations too. And the person who mentioned it better not just be quarterly coffee time. I mean, that's exactly, there's a danger of that. So we have to remember there's some urgency to this, and that we really need to be doing something, and it really will help to have that involvement. Even in the last quarter of this year, when we're trying to set it up and when we're trying to identify some things, we're going to be doing some work. So try to stay in touch, try to keep communicating, and we'll try to do the same. And I think that's probably enough said by me, and I don't see any other comments, so how about if we take the vote? All right. All those in favor say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Any opposed? Say no. Okay, that carries then. That will move forward. We do have one other piece of business before our committee. So committee members, stick around. The rest of you feel free to stay or leave.
Not sure how he did it. Thanks, Boulder. I forgot to be Boulder.
So this is our last item. It's from the health department. It's the Lead Hazard Control and Healthy Homes Grant. It's actually pretty exciting. As you guys are getting set up, I'll just kind of tee it up here a little bit. This is authorizing the grant acceptance of $3,400,000 from the U.S. Department of Housing and Urban Development. And we also want to kind of, as we're doing that, receive and file a presentation on lead in healthy homes services. So welcome.
Chair Gordon, council members, I'm Lisa Smithstead, and I am the manager of the Healthy Homes and Lead Hazard Control Program. Lead poisoning is a 100% preventable environmental disease. It can damage every system of the body and has health consequences for all age groups. It causes the most damage to children under 6 years old because this is such a critical time in their life for brain growth and development. Under 2 years of age, normal children are constantly putting objects and their fingers in their mouths. Where the household dust contains lead paint particles, this normal developmental behavior has devastating consequences. Lead is an environmental justice issue. It disproportionately affects children of poverty, immigrant populations, and children of color, and these impacts continue throughout their life. Lead poisoning has a great social justice and health disparity. 40% of Minneapolis children are children of color, but 80% of lead poisoned children in Minneapolis are children of color. This particularly impacts our Hispanic and our African American populations. Intact lead paint is not a hazard, but it is a paint that was only supposed to last for 30 years in the best of conditions, and that time period is past. As the paint ages, it pulls away from the wood, and you can see the characteristic cracking of lead paint at 90 degree angles, and this is referred to as alligatoring on the picture on the right. The picture on the left demonstrates two hazards of lead paint: cracking paint on the house, which when on the interior of the house can be attractive to children to pick at, and then the paint falling off the house and going into the soil. Lead paint will stay available in the first inch of soil for decades, easily accessible to any exploring toddler. Over the past 10 years, the Lead and Healthy Homes Unit has been very successful in securing grant dollars to improve the health of our residents by improving the housing stock. It would not have been possible to secure these grants without the support of the council and the general fund, which provides the mandatory matching dollars for these grants. What has been the result of these resources? Lead poisoning levels are steadily dropping as we continue to steadily remove hazards from children's environments. The general fund provides resources for inspection, and the grants provide resources to remediate the source of the problem. The combination is working to drive lead poisoning out of Minneapolis. When we go into homes for lead inspections, we see many other hazards that impact the health of our residents. Here you can see a rotting wall on the upper right-hand corner, and then a ceiling is falling down either from a plumbing leak or from a roof leak. There's mold on a basement wall here, but if you own a forced-air furnace, those mold spores are being circulated throughout the entire house. An electrical hazard is in the next picture, and it's also providing no light. If you combine that with a picture below of the stairwell with the missing railing, you could have a deadly situation. On the bottom right, there's a picture of that's ice. That weird looking clear stuff is ice in the door jam there. Because of the air gap on that door, that ice formed, which presented a problem for the heat in that unit, and it also did not allow the family to lock their door in the winter. The stairwell picture also has another hazard. It's an invisible hazard. It's a missing handrail on the staircase. The next two pictures are plumbing hazards. One is a dead rat that caused the sewage to back up into a home, and the next one is plumbing that was installed incorrectly, which could have allowed sewer gas to enter the home. In the bottom, there's asbestos insulation that also has a lot of cat feces mixed in it. What I can't show you is a picture of the invisible hazards, missing smoke and carbon monoxide detectors, and high levels of radon gas, all potentially deadly. These are just some of the home-based hazards that result in poor health outcomes for our residents in every age group, and sadly, an unhealthy start for many of our children. We are just wrapping up the 2011 Healthy Homes grant we received from HUD. Working with community-based organizations, we repaired the hazards in the previous slides. 200 homes received critical health and safety repairs. Some of these were homes of children with asthma. This program reduced asthma triggers such as mold, cockroaches, and mice that keep children up coughing at night, resulting in an inability for the child to go to school, maybe resulting in a trip to the emergency room, which in turn results in medical costs for parents, parents who are often employed in jobs that do not provide sick leave, so in addition to medical costs, they lose a day's pay when their child is sick. 40 houses will be warmer this winter and cost the families less to heat because with this grant, we remove the barrier to enrollment in a weatherization program. In partnership with Housing Inspections and CPED's Navigator program, we partnered on 8 homes, several of which were owned by physically or mentally challenged homeowners who would have had their homes condemned and become homeless without the electrical and plumbing repairs provided. We have helped people stay in their homes to age in place, raise healthy children, and saved homes from condemnation. We are all familiar with the story of how the war was lost for a want of nail on the horseshoe. Not only did the Healthy Homes grant provide the nail, we made sure it was hammered in place. Currently, we are in the last year of our 2012 Lead Hazard Control Grant Award. HUD has modified its grants process and is no longer issuing Healthy Homes grants. Instead, with the lead hazard control grant funds, now come with money for healthy home repairs. The combination of removing lead hazards and addressing health and safety hazards benefit the current residents, but also improves our housing stock and provides a more healthful environment in these homes into the future. Where are we now on lead poisoning? Medical research is showing that there is no safe level of lead. The Center for Disease Control dropped the level to 5 micrograms per deciliter of blood after medical research established that children with this level of exposure were permanently having brain development harmed. This impacts not just their school readiness, but is a lifelong burden on their health. This year, our unit had the resources to inspect and, through the grants, address the lead hazards in homes of children poisoned at 10 micrograms per deciliter of blood. On the right, you see how many children who were also poisoned but did not receive services. Lead poisoning occurs in every ward of the city, but tends to cluster in rental housing, in neighborhoods that experience poverty, and to children of color. The inspectors determine the source of the lead poisoning, which is usually lead dust or peeling paint on windows, window trim, or doors, or floors. For low-income families, the cost to remove these hazards can be cost prohibitive. Today, we are here before you with the council action to accept a $3.4 million lead hazard control grant from HUD. $3 million will go towards reducing lead hazards, an additional $400,000 for repairs of other health and safety hazards. These grant funds will allow us to make repairs in the homes of poisoned children. It is the combination of the city's general funds providing support for our program to investigate the lead poisoning, which qualifies as a match for these grants, that allow us to be successful in the competition for these grant funds to provide rehab to these properties and to work on removing this blight from our housing and from the children of our city. Do you have any questions?
I just have a couple questions. So you're confident that we have enough inspectors then to go out and identify the 280 homes?
Yes, I am. With the, there's a combination of the current inspectors in the mayor's budget, they also were going to give us another inspector. And then with the inspections in the lead hazard control grant, we should have enough.
Okay, and my second question was, do these also help with multifamily apartment buildings?
If a child, if the child is in a multi-unit building, yes, these funds are available. The funds are based on the income of the family, not on the landlord's income.
Okay, excellent. Do landlords have to consent to have the work done, or they must have to be involved somehow? And is that ever an issue?
Chair Gordon, yes, they not only have to consent, they also have to provide some matching funds.
And does that ever mean that the work doesn't get done? Because you're unable to get consent or matching, they're unable to get matching funds?
Chair Gordon, we also, with the EBL designation, we also have the power to write city orders on property owners to make these hazards be repaired. So they have a choice whether they could do the repairs on their own, or they could enroll in the grant, pay a matching fee of around 10%, and then we assist them with doing the repairs, which are usually replacing the windows as the most expensive element.
So generally then people comply and go along and the program because it's to their financial advantage.
Chair Gordman, yes, usually people comply and go along.
Wonderful. Councilmember Bender.
Thank you, Mr. Chair. I wondered, so we're finding this through inspections, but do we also get data from MDH where we're able to follow up with families who've had children or the county? Do we get data from somewhere that if a child has tested high to follow up or not? I don't know.
Councilmember Bender, Chair Gordon. Yes, the main focus of this grant is children who are poisoned, and that information comes to our department from the Department of Health, the State Department of Health, which receives all the reports in the state of poisoned children.
Okay, very good. I don't see any other questions, so thank you very much. I take it that concludes your presentation.
Yes, it does, but I would like to acknowledge Alex Vollmer here, who is the current project manager for the current lead hazard control grant. Eliza Schell, who ran the Healthy Homes grant, could not be here today. And my boss here, Dan Huff, who's helped us get these grants. Thank you.
Very good. Thank you so much. Then I will move the staff recommendation then to authorize execution of the grant, increase the appropriation, and receive and file the presentation, and we'll refer it to Ways and Means. All those in favor say aye.
Aye.
Any opposed say no. That motion carries then, and I think that's all our business today. Thank you, everyone, for participating, and this meeting is adjourned. Probably didn't thank Councilmember Glidden enough.
Congratulations.
Oh, thanks. Congratulations.